Welcome to Oster Oncology. This is Dr. David Oster. Today we will be discussing breast cancer recurrence prevention. So that is in the clinical scenario where surgery has already been received. And today we will go over the conventional therapies that surround surgery, as well as we will discuss the natural approaches that have evidence behind them that they can also help decrease the risk of the disease being seen again, typically within 5 years. That's the time frame that breast cancer recurrence is usually assessed by. So surgery is the primary centerpiece of therapy that needs to be received in early stages, stage 1, 2, and 3. And so that can be a mastectomy or a partial mastectomy, also called a lumpectomy. After that, we of course have radiation as a treatment option after surgery, and that can be usually over 6 weeks, but it can also be shortened to hypofractionated therapy. And then there's also intraoperative radiation therapy, IORT, which is it's more of a rare radiation therapy. Endocrine therapy, again, a lot of you listeners probably are familiar with either tamoxifen or aromatase inhibitors. That's an anti-estrogen therapy in estrogen receptor positive cases. And so all of these therapies are surrounding surgery, again, with the goal of decreasing recurrence risk. And so if we actually look at the benefit that they provide, typically, in early stage breast cancer, the remaining risk of seeing the disease come back after 5 years still sits, with just surgery alone, usually sits with a lumpectomy at around 20 to 30% chance over 5 years of seeing the disease come back, that's surgery alone. So radiation given after surgery is probably the most important post-operative therapy that is then recommended by your medical team, and that is because when radiation is applied after surgery, it drops the remaining recurrence risk from 30 down to around 10, sometimes single digits. It's typically understood that two-thirds of the remaining risk, the 30%, drops after radiation is given as well. So it can bring you down to maybe a 10 or 15 remaining risk at 5 years. After that, especially again in estrogen receptor positive cases, when surgery and radiation is delivered, often anti-estrogen therapies, the endocrine therapies, are also recommended at that time. And they can usually drop the remaining risk by another half of what's remaining, so maybe from 10% down to about 5%. So these therapies are very important in these early stages, stage 1, 2, and 3. They're critical in these early stages. Now, some cases may be recommended chemotherapy. That'll be discussed with your medical oncologist. And chemotherapy can be applied both before leading into surgery and then also after surgery as well. And they're not given just because medical oncologists like to give chemotherapy. They actually don't. But it's because they do have a proven benefit, percentage benefit as well. So before surgery is called neoadjuvant, after is called adjuvant. Neoadjuvant therapy is given with the hope of shrinking the tumor before surgery. And if we can completely shrink the tumor, that's called a pathological complete response. If that's achieved, the benefit with that percent of dropping recurrence risk is very significant over 5 and 10 years. And so again, to achieve that pathological complete response is a goal of the medical oncology team. Adjuvant therapy, this is chemotherapy after surgery, and it is typically given based on some recommendations from two different genetic tests that are now very much used in early stage disease, especially lymph node negative diseases. And again, they assess 21 different factors in the tumor with the oncotype, and the mammoprint tests 70 different genes, and it'll indicate if chemotherapy will be a benefit in your case. So this early stage is very important to receive these therapies. I've got too many cases that I've seen over the years in the hospital and in private practice where patients think that they have early stage. They think it's therefore easier to handle, less aggressive, less of a threat, and it's at that time where they elect to use natural therapies instead of these conventional therapies. It is a logic that is actually should be flipped on its head. It is in these early stages where, for instance, you see radiation there, It's in these early stages where surgery is a must. It's in these early stages where radiation typically is a must, or a mastectomy actually is equal to the surgery and the radiation. But these upfront, and I understand that there's side effects that come from them that are the concern that patients have, and they want to avoid them. I totally understand that. And the philosophy behind wanting to treat your body naturally, I understand, but it's in these early stages where conventional therapies boast their greatest benefit. It is not the time in early stage to decline them. But if we move forward to the natural evidence-based factors, the first one that is very well established to decrease recurrence risk as well as incidence is your sleep quality. So that is duration of sleep, that is length of sleep. And so the main reason, the main understanding of that is because of a little hormone you release called melatonin when you sleep, and only when you sleep. And so melatonin is starting to rise up in its concentration in the serum late in the evening, and then certainly deep quality sleep through the night. And melatonin is an anti-cancer hormone, definitely correlated with decreased risk of recurrence. Diet is another piece, and the number one approach that you could take with your diet is the Mediterranean diet. And I think there's two R's. I think I spelled that wrong there. Forgive me. But the virtues of the Mediterranean diet, the high plant life eating is intact. Healthy meats are selected over processed foods and unhealthy meats. There is a decreased additional excess sugar intake, and probably the greatest virtue of the Mediterranean diet is the oils. They are anti-inflammatory oils coming from olives. You see a little olive there, and fish. And so probably the greatest virtue is the oils. The nuts as well. Nuts have been established to decrease incidence of breast cancer. That's almonds and walnuts. But mushrooms have been established as delivering some anti-cancer benefit in estrogen receptor positive, particularly postmenopausal cases, where they actually have the activity of aromatase inhibition. So acting much like your aromatase inhibitors that your medical oncologist recommends. They're not substitutes, they're not quite as potent, but they do have that benefit. Again, decreasing risk of recurrence and incidence is exercise. Particularly, this has been established in estrogen receptor positive postmenopausal cases. And the benefit comes from primarily in reducing the fat or adipose tissue, we can call it, on the body. And we know that fat is actually a factory to produce estrogen, and that's the main connection between exercise and getting down to a really great ideal body weight. If we move to supplements, I'm always asked, what can we use to supplementally to decrease risk of recurrence? And if there's one Cadillac that stands out, and that is vitamin D. The normal range is 30 to 100 in the blood or in the serum. And so it's not so much how much you're taking in dose. The correlation is what are we achieving in the serum. So if we look at breast cancer incidence, and this can be translated to recurrence as well, and we compare that to the concentration of in the serum, and we have the range along the bottom, and as we move up in the range, you see the incidence drop as we move up within the normal range. And it's interesting that as you see the majority of cases, we find them certainly in the lower range deficiency, but we also find a large bulk of cases still within normal range, but in the low range, below 40, below 50. So it's in this 50 to 60 bracket and up that it has been established that if you move yourself up with even within the normal range, there is great benefit to be received. So I'll show you here. This is a study in 2018, by the way, and if they compared the lower range to the higher range, 60 plus. This is a study of over 5,000 women. And they compared if you were in the lower range versus if you were above 60 nanograms per mil. And the benefit was massive. It dropped the incidence and it dropped the risk by 82% if you move up high within the vitamin D range. So it should be tested. I certainly test it in all breast cancer cases. Other natural supplements and compounds to be considered, certainly the ones that have the most evidence for an anti-cancer benefit in breast cancer, would be curcumin, green tea extract, that's EGCG and resveratrol. That being said, in this particular clinical scenario, the percent benefit of decreasing the chance of recurrence over 5 years, it has not been established. So we don't have that data. I do include them in treatment survivorship plans for my patients. I certainly consider them when we speak of them and of incorporating them. But if we're honest and we look at the benefit they provide and compare it to the conventional therapies, so for instance, neoadjuvant or the adjuvant chemo, certainly the radiation and the endocrine therapies and hormone positive disease in the early stages, we cannot equate them. We cannot substitute, for instance, curcumin and feel we're confidently achieving the same thing as radiation or tamoxifen. It just doesn't work that way. So but we do consider them certainly in the treatment plans, and I use them all the time. But I need to stress again the conventional therapies in early stage and the benefit they bring. It is the time to receive these therapies. It is early stage. Though we do have major impact on recurrences with sleep, the Mediterranean diet and the oils, the other additional dietary add-ons that you can consider, exercise and getting you an ideal weight is a must. It's something we work for with all of our patients. Certainly assessing vitamin D levels and monitoring that consistently over the 5 years at least. These other natural supplements can be considered. Curcumin, green tea extract, again, we use them. I think they are fantastic in that setting. But again, the conventional medicine is boasting its greatest benefit in early stage. I've got too many patients coming in saying that they had an opinion from some natural clinic saying that with some IV therapies and so forth that they can cure their disease and there's no need for something like radiation. There's no need for some things like where chemotherapy is recommended. And I've seen too many cases come back to me after 2-3 years of declining this conventional treatments in early stage, and it's developed into something more aggressive. It's developed into something that's metastatic and has spread. So evidence-based integrative oncology is at its best when it incorporates all these fantastically established natural factors, but also affirms the conventional treatments that also boast a tremendous benefit long-term to decrease the risk of recurrence and ever seeing the disease come back again. So integrative oncology, naturopathic medicine in oncology can help you tolerate and get through all of these treatments, whether they be recovering from surgery, recovering from radiation, protecting you through radiation, certainly toleration of the endocrine therapies, and definitely tolerating the chemotherapies, while at the same time establishing a very comprehensive protocol, getting you sleeping great, getting you eating great, using the really key targeted established supplements, and then also making sure that we're getting into some exercise programs. So all of these things can be developed for you and packaged for you in a great treatment plan. So hopefully this was a good summary for you and really laying out. Sometimes it's nice to visualize the percent benefits that these different therapies can offer and provide. And then also seeing the established evidence-based natural approaches you can take that we know are correlated with decreased risk of recurrence, and teasing those out from a lot of the misplaced, exaggerated claims that you can find everywhere on the internet and so forth. So hopefully this was a good review for you. From Oster Oncology to all of you, fight stronger and fight smarter.